On Saturday night, a brawl broke out at the Cessnock showground. As a result, four men have been charged with assault. They are Ian Price, Wayne Mendham, Rodney Keelty and Anatole Skripka, all of Sydney. They've been reprimanded on $10,000 bail and will reappear at Cessnock Court on the 18th of April. Despite this unfortunate incident, the chairman of the Hunter Vintage Festival, Mr Murray Tyrrell, says the festival has been a real triumph for wine growers in the area.
I think the festival has been tremendously successful. We set out to promote the Hunter Valley and to promote wine generally with the festival, and I think we've done that. One of the outstanding things that's happened is has been the media coverage we've got for both wine and food, and this has been on a national basis. The wine press from all over Australia have been entertained here, and the press generally, even leading up to the festival, has been unbelievable with supplements and things that we've got, and there's a lot more to come. So I think we've done a lot to publicise the area, and that's what it's all about.
When will the next festival be?
I think it will be next year. I think we've proved that the numbers probably weren't as many to come through the area as we'd thought or first anticipated we would get, but I think that one of the things that has happened is that there's been quite a few years since there's been a festival of any sort, and I think we need to go on now. We've set a standard and set a base. I think we've got to go on with this, and I'd very much like to see the festival continue on next year.
The figures are contained in this 20-page document entitled Employment and Unemployment in the Hunter, Patterns and Influences. In a news release accompanying the report, the task force says it has complained repeatedly about the lack of regional unemployment data available locally. The secretary of the task force is Mr. Mike Hamill, who, apart from being a public servant with the State Department of Industrial Relations, also conducts a weekly radio talk on 2NUR-FM. Mr. Hamill says regional figures are vital if anything is to be done towards planning our way out of this dilemma.
We're largely a manufacturing industry town, and at the moment the decline worldwide is most evident in manufacturing industry, and that is having a big impact. And of course we're a steel town, and obviously the retrenchments and retirements there are having their impact very quickly.
What do you think can be done about it?
I guess what we've got to look at very carefully is where we go from here. I don't think the downturn in the international economy or the local economy is something that's causing all our unemployment. I think a lot of our unemployment is what they call structural unemployment. That is, our actual workforce, the people who are employed in it, is changing dramatically. And I think to get around that, we're going to have to look at new areas of work. We're going to have to look at high technology industries. We're going to have to look at boosting tourism, which for this region is perhaps one of the best possibilities for employing large numbers of people.
Thank you, John. Good morning. We've had extensive light rain along most of the coast during the night, and there's the possibility of a further showers on the coastal fringe during today and even thunderstorms in the Upper Hunter this afternoon. Most of New South Wales covered in cloud, expecting rain in the southern areas, especially along the south coast, with further light patchy falls along most of the rest of the coast. Around the beaches this morning, quite nice, even though it has been a little bit wet. The waves are only small, but conditions are nice and smooth and glassy. The wind only light on shore from the east-southeast at the moment. Will pick up during the day, and the best waves will be found later this morning. At the moment, conditions a little bit full coming on towards high tide. Waves up to 1 metre at most of the open beaches. A few people in the water, board riders enjoying those early morning conditions with the smoother waves, and a few people also swimming and running along the beach as per usual. As far as the swimmers are concerned this morning, all of our city beaches are quite safe, and it does look like being rather a pleasant day for the beach a little later when the cloud starts to clear a little. As far as the forecast is concerned, we have a moderate to higher fire danger, a warm day inland, tempered on the coast by northeasterly winds at 20 to 30 kilometres per hour, a little rain mainly in the south and the risk of an afternoon thunderstorm in the Upper Hunter, slight seas and a low swell. Newcastle today heading for a top of 26 degrees, Scone heading for 32 and Taree expecting a top of 30. The outlook for Wednesday, southeasterly winds with a few showers. High tide this morning will be at 8:50, 1.7 metres, Low tide will be at 13 minutes past 3 this afternoon at 0.4 of a metre. Well, that's our look at the surf and weather. Small waves for the board riders, a little rain along the coast, the possibility of an afternoon thunderstorm in the Upper Hunter. Looks like it might be a great afternoon for the beach. Hope you enjoy it. We'll be back again tomorrow morning.
Things have been calm and quiet at Maitland all day, despite a walkout by warders at 8 o'clock this morning. The State Secretary of the Prison Officers Association, Mr. Mike Behan, said the action was being taken in retaliation against the transfer of an officer from the Maitland Emergency Squad to a position inside the jail. Mr. Behan said the transfer was being done entirely without consultation with his association and at the whim of the department, and he described that as a practice which could not be allowed to continue. Mr. Behan said the officer was being punished because of an escape from police cells at Darlinghurst a fortnight ago. He said the officer concerned had already handed over one of two prisoners to police custody and so was not directly responsible when they escaped. He said the officer was being punished without being charged and the 100 warders at Maitland would not return to work until he's reinstated in the emergency squad. The association has been seeking talks with the Minister for Corrective Services all day, and the warders themselves will meet at Maitland at 8 o'clock in the morning to discuss any developments in the dispute. Recently, council has been rocked by bitter squabbling between aldermen and senior council officers. Council officers claim aldermen have been unnecessarily critical of their work and that a serious morale problem has developed. The problem is so bad that a special meeting of council has been called for tonight to try and resolve the matter. All senior council officers are expected to attend what will be a closed meeting at 7:30. The Mayor of Maitland, Alderman Ron Walsh, was quoted in the Maitland Mercury newspaper today as saying that the Minister's decision not to hold an inquiry doesn't surprise him. He's quoted as saying that there's no need for such an inquiry, but there are some who disagree. For instance, Alderman Barry Maher will move a motion tonight calling for just such an examination. Alderman Maher says it's vital the air be cleared and an independent inquiry is the only way to do that.
Well, I would like to see that we have this full local government inquiry. Despite what the Minister has said, that it being a domestic issue, we can only clear the air by a full and complete inquiry by the local government inspectors coming up and looking into the way the council's going. We've got nothing at all to hide. We want everyone to know what's going on in Maitland Council and then let them be the judges to see that what we're doing is in the best interest of the people of the City of Maitland.
At the Newcastle Masonic and City Bowling Club, three quarter final matches tomorrow in the Masters singles, and they show a lot of interest. Barry Solder plays Matt Hayes, Peter Wolfgang plays B. Troy of Lambton, and Brian Dakin plays Alan Fraser. All matches should be full of interest tomorrow. In the Toshiba Maestro pairs at the Hamilton North Bowling Club, the four divisions have joint leaders. Mosman and Spohr and Suvalich and Saunders are joint leaders in the A section, while Frost and Hill and King and Wright are joint leaders in B. In the C section, we have three joint leaders, Noel Mills and Terry Byrne, Ron Annan and Terry Webster, and Don Shoesmith and Bill Farragut. In D section, a sole leader, Charlie Bagwell and Alan Baker. That will all be sorted out tomorrow morning. Thank you.
Although the Unimog has been in production for almost 30 years, it's relatively unknown in Australia. But that's now been changed by an Australian Army contract for 1,300 vehicles similar to this one. That justifies an Australian assembly operation with 40% local content. Today's demonstration was designed to show just how versatile the machine can be. With its German rail conversion, the Unimog can shunt up to 600 tonnes. In this configuration, it costs $120,000, but that's less than half a conventional shunting engine, and its designers argue that when shunting is finished, the Unimog can be used for other purposes. If it sells, there's a spin-off for a Newcastle company, Elron. Based at Toronto, Elron has plans to manufacture the rail guidance system under license from its German designers.
Talent, a fresh beauty with Streisand fervour. Her range, her sense of phrasing and pathos are nearly impeccable. So is her repertoire. Welcome praise for a cabaret artist anywhere, but especially pleasing for an Australian performing in New York. But that's what New York critics had to say about Geraldine Turner when she performed last year at Sweetwater's.
The acceptance that you had in New York, how important is that to you as an artist?
Well, I mean, I enjoyed getting good reviews. Anybody enjoys getting good reviews. But it's not terribly important to me. It's terribly important in the way that other people see you. So somebody once said to me that the interesting thing about fame is that when you become famous, you don't change, but your friends change in the way they treat you. And I don't think for a second I'm famous. I'm not saying that. I'm just using it because I think Australians still consider that if you haven't worked anywhere else but Australia, you can't really be, you know, that good. So it's important in that way.
If you didn't wear green at the entrance today, you just weren't getting into the spirit of things. Shop owners at the Lakeside Plaza helped in efforts to give the centre a distinctly Irish feel. There was a display of a traditional Irish cottage, and a full array of provincial flags as well as the national flag were flown. Entertainment was provided by the dancers from the Sheena McCaig School of Irish Dancing. Organisers were also searching for the prettiest and best presented colleen. That's the traditional term for a young Irish maiden. And they also kept a lookout for the best presented leprechaun in the plaza. Many stores and organisations, including NBN, were there with giveaways and prizes.
We think in terms of looking after the mother and baby. There are obstetricians, paediatricians, midwives, radiologists, pathologists, and they are all members of the perinatal team. If their complete interest medically is in the care of mothers and babies, then I suppose they can call themselves perinatal paediatricians or perinatal obstetricians. But the idea of the term is really to bring together a whole range of disciplines, all of whom have an input into the health and care of the mother and baby around the time of birth.
To yesterday's rainy conditions resulted in many interruptions to play at the District Park tennis courts. The satellite tournament is very important for those ambitious young players who see it as a way to gain confidence and improve their standing in the world circuit, as 24-year-old American Armand Molino explains.
To me personally, they're important because I've recently raised my ranking from over 800 now into the 200s. So any satellite I play, I can build more points and increase my ranking and hopefully get into some Grand Prix tournaments later this year.
Today's inquiry was held in the Newcastle City Hall before Mr. Brian Carl, Chairman of the Board, and Mrs. Fuller Quinn, a member of the Board. Two Arcadia Vale builders, Mr. Colin Murchie and Mr. John Fairful, were asked to show why action should not be taken against their licences following complaints from a consumer, Mr. Ron Field of Awabba. Mr. Field was unsatisfied with work carried out on his bathroom in 1976. In the second hearing, the board alleged that Frank Kelly Pools failed on two occasions to comply with rectification orders issued by the board. The evidence heard today will be submitted to the full board, which will hand down its decision at a later date. The board has the power to fine builders up to $500 or disqualify their license. Can also offer consumers compensation through its statutory insurance policy. Mr. Carl, the chairman of the board, says it's imperative that domestic work be carried out by a licensed tradesman.
It is absolutely essential that not only with builders but with tradesmen, that if you're having any work done on your home, that you check with the board to make sure that the person you're going to deal with holds a proper license for the work that's going to be carried out. Otherwise, there's no consumer protection at all.
Mrs. Margot Sanders is a leading personality in the Anglican community. She's the wife of Archdeacon Sanders, the former rector of Coffs Harbour. As the national president of the Mothers' Union, Mrs. Sanders represents the Church on Women's Matters, promoting the permanence of the Christian marriage and a stable family life. At the day's civic reception, Mrs. Sanders called on the women of the Mothers' Union to bring Christian love into their homes. Mrs. Sanders is the mother of five children. One of her daughters is well-known ABC radio personality, Libby Sanders. Mrs. Sanders says now more than ever, the family unit is facing enormous pressures.
I really feel that there's so much pressure on family life today that we have a very real place in family life for those whom we can influence.
The Mothers' Union bases its principles on family life very much on the Christian faith, is that right?
Yes. It is a Christian organisation, the Anglican Church, the oldest organisation for women in the Anglican Church, formed 106 years ago.
Coming to Newcastle for you is not such a difficult thing because you're not a stranger. Of course, there's your daughter Libby here with you.
That's right, John.
Good yes. to see Mum again.
Of course it is, John. It's wonderful. We don't get together often enough, unfortunately. But
the question is, with your mother in the Mothers' Union and you recently married, is there a chance that you'll be joining the Mothers' Union in the future?
I don't know, John. I really can't answer that question at all.
Said Edward Hammond Hargraves, the man originally credited with the discovery of gold in the Bathurst, which began the rush of the 1850s. Katara High's production chronicles the events that followed the discovery, showing that Hargraves falsely took credit for the discovery. Today was dress rehearsal time. The musical took two teachers from the school 12 months to write. Peter Langley created the script, and John Mackay wrote the original musical score. I asked Peter why they chose Hargraves as their subject.
Well, Hargraves was one of the greatest rogues in Australian history. He also lived around this area at Nora Head, and we decided to concentrate on a rogue rather than someone like Captain Cook.
The cast involves 70 students of the school, including musicians, ranging in age from 14 to 17. A stuffed horse is playing at the Cardiff High on Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday, and Saturday nights this week.